to boldly go where no man has gone before.
Hello, everybody. It is episode number 7 of season 3 of Star Trek. Last time, we had Spectre of the Gun. And we did it. We had a lot of guns, actually, and I don't think we used any of them at any point. I believe we didn't shoot anybody in the previous episode. And it was all in Kirk's mind, or the collective minds of all of them. Or something. It was interesting. I like the Wild West feel to it. I like that it was oddly that having it on a set rather than going on location added a certain unreal element to it, which added to the episode. Usually the on-set stuff detracts from the episode, and I'm basking in, you know, anytime they go away from a set, I'm like, ah, we're in the real world. This is great. But last episode is an exception to that. It was kind of eerie, you know. And Chekhov, well, do you think he found true love when they went to that planet in the end, at the end of the episode? I can't believe they just ignored their probe saying, please turn away. We're here on a peaceful mission. How dare you stop us? We're going to beam down to your planet, whether you like it or not. We come in peace. What are you talking about? You, what? What kind of weird? Don't get me started. Let's reset our brain and think about Dave the Dove. Dave the Dove. Completely opposite title to Spectre of the Gun. I'm expecting peace, love, and harmony. And maybe Noah. And a boat. And two of every animal. Three doves, just in case something happened to the dove we sent out. Didn't we send one out looking for land? Wasn't that it? And then God sent a rainbow. As a warning to humanity not to cross him again. Yeah, I remember. Let us get into Day of the Dove. Oh, look at this planet. Oh, we're beaming down already. That guy looks like Galloway. Like, he looks really like him. From, he died, like, from a lot of episodes, but he died in the Omega Glory. Captain Crazy. Crazy Eyes. Killed him with a phaser. There's no coming back from that. Like, I know they pumped blood or salt. They pumped blood back into Leslie to bring him back to life in Obsession, but I don't know how you recombine, you know, elements to recreate a fully human. Maybe his pattern was in the transporter beam. We reconstructed him. Or maybe it's just a different actor. I'll be paying attention, though. I know what Galloway looks like. I'll be paying attention. What's here? Where are we? Plants.
Report, Mr. Chekhov.
Radiation level normal. No evidence of a colony nor any residual after effect of a force that might have annihilated it.
Life readings, Dr. McCoy?
Nothing.
We were unable to detect the
fire.
An entire human colony. 100 men, women, and children. Who did it? Why?
There's a fireball, Kirk.
Spock here, Captain.
Sensors have picked up a Klingon ship.
They're Klingons.
Protect yourselves. Total reply if attacked.
Total reply.
Trouble aboard the Klingon ship. Evidence of explosions.
Oh, they're beaming down too.
The enemy ship is drifting,
and we never fired upon her.
Maintain red alert.
Hey, fellas, what's going on?
You attacked my ship.
Who's this Klingon? Do we know this Klingon from another episode? We know this actor, don't we? We do. Was he a Klingon in... Which episodes have had the Klingons? Why won't my brain work? He's not Kor. He's not Trelane. Trelane Klingon guy. He's not him. That was a Romulan episode. That doesn't count. Oh, there was the Private Little War. I'm not sure if he was... He could have been that Klingon on that planet. Can't quite remember. And... I just don't know. I'll have to, maybe it'll come to me.
100 of my crew dead. Kirk, my ship is disabled.
Oh, I know it. No, he's... I know who this is. This actor is... He's been in... he was in an Outer Limits episode called... Soldier, and we've seen him in a couple of other things. I know exactly who he is.
I claim yours. You are now prisoners of the Klingon Empire, against which you have committed a wanton act of war.
We didn't do anything. What? Look at the fireball. The fireball. Have I got the right episode on? This is Day of the Dove, isn't it? Maybe we gotta make peace with the Klingons once and for all. We definitely have that Galloway look-alike on the planet to kill him, though, don't we? Imagine if they kept killing the same red shirt over and over. Can nobody else see this except me? Am I going crazy? Yeah, Bixby.
We took no action against your ship.
Didn't do anything. Man.
Were the screams of my crew imaginary?
There was a Federation colony on this planet. It was destroyed.
No bodies, no ruins. A colony of the invisible.
Yeah.
Yes, test of a new Klingon weapon, leaving no traces.
We have wondered when you would begin.
Nobody trusts anybody.
My ship into ambush by a false Klingon distress call.
You received a distress call. We received a distress call.
The Enterprise is mine!
Yeah, good luck with that, dude.
Instruct your transporter room to beam us aboard.
Go to the devil.
Go to the devil.
We have no devil, Kirk.
Go to hell, man.
But we understand the habits of yours.
Wow.
I shall torture you. One by one. Who will be first?
I think we know who's going to be first.
Cossack!
Oh, Chekhov!
Stinky Klingon man!
No, you volunteered, Chekhov!
You kill my brother, Peter!
Oh.
You kill my brother!
Volunteer to join him. That is loyalty.
He's volunteering. Oh, a pain giver.
Chekhov! Stop the torture! Jim, you can't hand over the Enterprise.
That wasn't long.
Don't plan any tricks, Kirk. I will kill 100 hostages at the first sign of treachery.
100? We only have 4.
I'll beam you aboard the Enterprise. Once there, no tricks.
What's the plan, Kirk? This is odd.
Mr. Spock, we have guests. Beam up everyone in the target area.
Oh, a little secret code, Sark.
Understood, Captain.
Are we just getting our 4? No, we're getting everybody. Hey, you, do you want to come too? It's fun up there. I think it came too. Do we beam the others to the brig?
Good work, Spock. All others suspended in transit.
Suspended in transit?
Johnson?
Security man on the way, sir.
Captain.
He's not Johnson.
Leave them where they are. Non-existence.
Bring them in.
Luckily, they're all pointed away. Element of surprise. You said no tricks, Kirk.
Liar!
Said no tricks after we reached the ship.
There are still survivors aboard my ship.
There's too much radiation coming from that Klingon ship. It's a hazard to the vicinity.
Prepare to destruct.
Prepare to destruct, but there's still people there.
First group from the Klingon vessel, Captain.
Oh, okay. We've got women, too. Is this the first time we've seen a Klingon woman? I think so.
My wife, Mara, and my science officer.
Kang, what has happened?
Kang.
More Federation treachery.
What will they do to us?
Torture, probably.
I've heard of their atrocities.
Yeah.
Their death camps. They will torture us for our scientific and military information.
Yeah, and then you'll break their dilithium mines.
You'll be well treated, Kang.
More tricks.
Secure from red alert. But maintain...
It's naval or whatever Starfleet is copying. It's so weird. Secure from red alert. It's just such a weird, grammatically weird. Secure from general quarters. you know? It's so, I can't, it's like code. It's like code to me. It probably sounds very natural to people who are used to it, but for me it's like, what are you talking about? Give me more clear instructions. Anyway, now that I've paused it, once again, we can't still, can we really think that the Klingons are responsible for the destruction of the planet? When the Klingons are so adamant that the Federation is responsible for the deaths on their ship. You know? Is anybody thinking, hey, maybe we both have a common enemy. Maybe something external, a third party, is responsible for both our situations. I don't know. Anyway, we're going to be treating them well. We're not going to be torturing them for information or anything. So maybe we will extend the first olive branch and we could work together to figure out what that glowing ball of flame is. Send it packing back to Andromeda. All the bad things come from Andromeda, remember?
The moment we received the distress signal from the colony on Beta 12A, the Klingons were too far distant to have been the attackers.
Right, Spock. Nobody can see this.
Lies! They want to start the war by pretending that we did! You're
right. Yeah, Chekhov.
What proof do we need? We know what a Klingon is.
Ooh, McCoy. Harsh words. Hey, Chekhov. Don't do anything crazy, okay?
Klingon ship is vacated, sir.
Very good, Scotty. Miss Sulu? Lieutenant Uhura?
No contact with Starfleet as yet, sir.
What's your game? What do you want? Oh, it's down the ladder it went.
I'll have Kirk's head stuffed and hung on his cabin wall.
We are 40 against 400.
They will make the mistake.
They all have cool goatees. Can you sense this thing, Uhura?
Make sense.
What is it?
Channels are open. I don't understand it, sir. Could the Klingons be doing something?
She's frustrated. What was that?
Change of course. Accelerating.
Where to?
Scotty, stop all engines.
What have I done, sir? Controls have gone crazy. The engines, sir, they've gone to what? 9? By themselves.
New course. 902 Mark 5. That'll take us out of the galaxy.
Oh, out of the galaxy again. Again.
Report coming in from the lower decks. Emergency bulkheads have closed. Almost 400 crewmen are trapped down there, sir.
Do you think it just wants to go home? This ball of fire?
The bulk of your crew trapped? Your ship racing from this galaxy at wild speeds? Delightful. How did I perform this sabotage, Kirk?
Johnson, some Klingons may have beamed aboard undetected from the wrecked ship.
They could be wearing disguises.
And before I put you in the brig, there's a little something I owe you.
Yeah. Oh, no, where did that come from? Can we question stuff like this?
Lasers.
Okay, everybody calm down, okay? This is clearly a third party. Come on. Let's not... Get Sulu down here. No, we're fighting. There's only four of us. We can't hold them. Let's seal off the deck. They'll just use the ladders. Hey, Kirk, what are you doing on a sword? Do you think it's weird?
Scotty, deploy forces to protect your section and the auxiliary control center.
And try and free those trapped crewmen.
The Klingon Empire has maintained a dueling tradition. They think they can beat us with swords.
What?
Neither
what?
The Klingon technology nor ours is capable of this.
Yeah, Kirk.
Any other logical candidate?
A third party.
None.
Mr. Sulu, get below. Take command of engineering and auxiliary control.
Sulu's in his element.
Captain. Mr. Chekhov, as you were.
Take off, sir!
Oh, for his brother. For his brother.
I saw what they left of Pyotr. I swore on his grave I would avenge his murder.
Well, this is coming from nowhere, though, Chekhov. You didn't even have a brother until this episode.
What's Chekhov's grudge against the Klingons?
His brother.
Who's Pyotr?
His only brother, killed in a Klingon raid.
But he doesn't have a brother.
He never had a brother. Yes. He's an only child.
The thing I made up as a joke is true. I thought, you know, the convenient way everybody they meet is like somebody they were in Starfleet Academy with, their instructor or classmate or something. I thought they just invented Chekhov's brother just to give them something to do in this episode. But that's just a lie, an implanted memory in his brain to get him distracted. Maybe the energy ball just wants us all to kill ourselves so we can fly back to Andromeda peacefully. It tried to take over tried to do it with the Klingon ship, but it realized the ship was too busted up to make the journey. I don't know why it destroyed the... Maybe there was no colony settlement on this planet. You know, maybe that was just an illusion too. We can't trust anything. At least Spock is sane. He's like, Kirk, you know... Did you stop to think about the sword situation?
Sulu, get down to engineering.
Aye, sir.
Why would Chekov believe he has a brother?
I don't know, but he does.
Kirk is very tanned, isn't he?
Now he wants revenge for a non-existent loss.
Nothing's going to stop him. He's going to kill every Klingon on board the ship. Red means kill. What did I do to you?
Oh, you don't keep hacking at a man after he's down.
What are you gonna do, Doc? Gonna release a gas to get them all? A biological weapon? What section is this?
Layout and specifications of the Enterprise, Commander.
Enemy numbers are the same as ours.
Then we take this ship. First, engineering.
Yep. Scotty, watch out.
What about the armory?
Well, I'm there now, sir. You never saw such a fine collection of antiques in your life.
Oh, nice.
Get back to engineering. And talk to Ordnance about manufacturing phaser replacements.
Aye, sir.
I think they just get replaced with these, though. Yeah, that's a good one.
Oh,
that's a good one. You'll get the Klingons with that one, Scotty.
What blazes is going on?
Scans indicate that our forces and those of the Klingons are exactly equal at 38 each.
Balance of power. It's only Scotty, Sulu.
Any signs of those devils, Mr. Sulu?
All clear, Mr. Scott.
Oh, there's one snuck in through the vents. Ah. Get him! Get him! Oh, chop. Why use a sword when you have a hand? Well, they have engineering now. Swift and efficient.
It is an alien life force, a single entity.
Just one.
An alien life force.
It's floating around, manipulating people.
Computer report.
Alien life force on board is composed of pure energy, type unknown. Actions indicate intelligence and purpose.
What purpose?
Insufficient data for further analysis.
A brother that never existed. A phantom colony. Imaginary distress calls. Do you sense a pattern, Mr. Spock?
You know, look, let's just say it's not trying to get home. Let's just say that's not it, right? Could be at the edge of the galaxy, could be in a different galaxy. Let's just pretend where the ship is going is not of no importance. Maybe it wants to, it's even the odds, it's made all the humans and Klingons equal numbers to give each a perfectly equal chance of defeating the other. Maybe it's just an experiment. Like a third-party war game, you know, to see what would happen if humans and Klingons were pitted against each other on an equal footing, to see which is the better. But I say, it's the day of the dove, not the day of the... sword. But, how do we get the Klingons to see it? They won't like being manipulated any more than we like being manipulated. So, if it's a benevolent third-party creature, then the answer is peace. Otherwise, shoot it, kill it, beam it somewhere else, smash it, throw any matter at it. Can you believe I said this one was going to be about peace, love, and harmony?
It is apparently capable of manipulating matter and mind. We cannot know at this moment. whether our own memories are completely accurate and true.
Yeah, we can't trust anything.
We must talk to Kang. Bury the hatchet.
We don't have any hatchets.
However, it is notoriously difficult to arrange a truce with the Klingons.
Truce?
Oh, here we go.
You serious?
Here we go.
If our backs would turn, they'd jump us in a minute.
Of course.
While you're talking, they're planning attacks. This is a fight to the death. We'd better start trying to win it. We should wipe out every one of them.
The alien is the real threat.
Sick bay calling, Doctor. There are more wounded men requiring your attention.
I don't know. I don't think the doc's in a good state of mind.
How many more men must die before you two begin to act like military men?
Maybe Christine should be in charge. Until further notice. Scotty? Oh, it's Kang.
This is Kang. Now control this ship's power and life support systems.
I have deprived all areas except our own.
Uh-oh.
We'll die from suffocation.
What can we do now?
Captain, get down to emergency manual control. Try to protect our life support circuits.
Aye, Captain. Scotty!
Wait.
Check off us late, Captain.
Hey, Scotty.
We should have left those fuzz-faced goons in the transporter.
Fuzz-faced goons.
You've jeopardized the Federation!
Calm down, Scotty.
Scott. Keep your fucking hands off me.
Oh.
You green-blooded half-breed.
It's not like you, Scotty.
Say that I have not thoroughly enjoyed serving with humans. I find their illogic a constant irritant.
Then transfer out, freak!
Freak? Try your trick from the last episode.
Spock.
Hey, Spock.
Spock.
Calm down.
Stop it! You're half-human! What are we saying?
Fascinating. Stress.
We've been under stress before. It's never set us at each other's throats.
This is war!
There isn't any war! Look at me.
We're being manipulated. You know it.
Look at me.
Two forces, each of them equally armed.
Yeah.
Has a war been staged for us?
Apparently, it is by design that we fight. We seem to be pawns.
But what's the game? And whose?
That's the big mystery.
There's a Sulu report.
No good, Captain. Circuits are in, but systems just aren't responding.
How about now? How about now, Sulu?
Power and life support restored.
Good work.
But Captain...
You didn't do anything.
I didn't do it.
Even playing field again.
Their life support systems have resumed.
Start scanning. Let's find that alien.
Holding steady.
Cause him to be unsteady.
They appear to be controlled from another location.
One of Kirk's tricks.
Yep. He's formidable. What you up to, Ball of Flame?
Alien detected in the engineering section near reactor number 3.
Let's go.
I love we're taking our swords with us. Oh! Okay, Chekhov, can you see it? Chekhov's not gonna rest till he gets his revenge. Here comes the Klingon now, Chekhov. Now's your chance. Two of them. I'm one of them, Kang's wife.
You don't die yet.
That's creepy.
You're not human, but you're very beautiful.
Hey, Chekhov, mind back in the game, Chekhov.
He's not responsible.
Nap out of it. Mind meld him, Spock.
What have I done?
You have no brother. Maybe she can convince Kang.
There's an alien entity aboard the ship. Don't know what its motive is. We're trying to find out. You must help us. A temporary truce, that's all I ask.
Yeah. We don't have to be friends forever. We could fight afterwards, when the alien's gone.
Take her.
Check. Hit him again, Kirk. Check. Hit him again.
Is this what's in store for us?
How's Johnson doing? Don't kill her, McCoy. I know you hate her and everything.
Brainwaves show almost paranoid mania. What happened?
You lost control. We're becoming animal warriors.
Johnson's heart wound is almost completely healed.
Oh, good.
Same with the other casualties. Massive trauma, shock. They're all healing at a fantastic rate.
Oh, great, great. So it's not a... No stakes, then. No stakes. Let's just have our war game. You know, whoever wins, wins, and then we all heal up. then the orb can go back to its planet, can write its novel, you know, War and Peace, and then, you know, nobody read it because it's way too long. Way too long, orb. Could you just shorten it down a bit, you know?
It would appear that the entity wants us alive.
So we can fight? Keep coming back for more like some bloody Colosseum? You come with us. Maybe we can prove to you that it exists.
Nobody's seen it yet. It was right there. It was right there. Ooh. Oh. Hey, what do you want?
What did you want?
Reporting for duty, sir.
Hey, Johnson.
Can I release you from sickbay?
I release myself.
Uh-oh.
I'm fit and ready for action.
There's a Klingon right there.
And I'm not even the score.
I order you to get
I've got my orders. I'm obeying orders. It's never us, isn't it?
Johnson!
Hey, Johnson, there was a Klingon right there. Instead of picking a fight with Kirk, you should have gone straight for her. You know, the orb was glowing red. Red means dead. Remember? I don't know what this color means.
Fascinating. When the lieutenant became unconscious, the alien lost energy.
Yep.
It subsists on the emotions of others.
Oh, it needs us to survive.
It exists on the hate of others.
And it has acted as a catalyst, creating this situation.
And kept numbers and resources balanced. We've got to get rid of it.
Then all hostile attitudes on board must be eliminated, and soon.
Or we're a doomed ship, traveling forever between galaxies. Kang has got to listen. We've got to pool our knowledge.
She can convince him. Good thing this thing is just hanging around, by the way. It was hiding for most of the episode, and then it just decided to stop and say hello.
Kang, this is Captain Kirk.
We have your wife.
Commander, it's a trick!
Ah, she wasn't convinced, apparently.
The ship's dilithium crystals are deteriorating. We can't stop the process.
Oh.
In 12 minutes, we'll be totally without engine power.
But doesn't the alien need to go somewhere?
Do whatever you can. Kirk out.
Hey, can you help us with our dilithium, little buddy?
And so we drift in space.
Forever.
With only hatred and bloodshed aboard.
Yeah.
Now do you believe...
Our own private little war. It's just when I said those words, our own private little war. We got two factions on that planet. And an immense power from both sides that can do whatever they want with these people. And they choose to give them equal weapons. Whenever one has an advantage, the other gets the advantage, and so on and so on. And it maintains this balance. Doesn't it? Locked in combat forever on this planet. To suit the needs of the overseers. Now, are we feeding on the energy of the hatred of those tribes on that planet? No. I still don't know what we need that planet for, but you know, maybe it's not about needing that planet. Maybe it's just about the Klingons not getting it. Anyway, it just seems similar. Especially balancing the always keeping the balance exactly right. One loses power, then they get it back again. You know? One has too many people, they get cut off. But the dilithium, that's a problem. You know, surely the alien doesn't want to be drifting in space forever. Then again, look, if we're traveling at a particular speed, we can just turn everything off and maybe keep... I don't know. That works for conventional velocities, but maybe not warp drive. You know what I mean? Like for a conventional velocity, once you're traveling and you cut all power, you'll keep going at that speed indefinitely. But I'm not sure about warp drive stuff. Maybe once you cut that power, it's just the bubble disappears and you're not going anywhere.
Captain's log, stardate
Armageddon. There's no change, Captain. The dilithium crystals are discharging.
If I could talk to Kang, cut through the Klingon lines and make peace before it's too late.
Kang's wife is, after all, our prisoner.
Yeah.
Perhaps a threat.
Now that's something the Klingons would understand.
Okay, let's pretend to threaten to kill her.
Kang,
we have Marith, your wife. We talk truce now.
Yeah.
Or she dies, reply.
Are you too coward to come talk truce with me?
She has 5 seconds to live. Reply.
He is a victim of war, Captain.
No.
You called my bluff.
You're not going...
The Federation doesn't kill or mistreat its prisoners.
So this was no trick.
It's the alien that's done this.
Yeah, the alien.
We only wanted to stop the fighting to save us all.
We have always fought.
No, fight the alien.
We are hunters, Captain.
Hunt the alien.
I will help you now.
Ah, great.
I will add my voice to yours.
I wouldn't trust her, Captain.
We gotta trust somebody.
Can't get through the Klingon defenses in time. Unless... intra-ship beaming. From one section to another, it's possible.
Oh, we've not done that before.
She may be leading you into a trap.
We're all in a trap. I believe her.
Let's try it.
But she can't guarantee that Kang will stop to listen.
Nope.
No one can guarantee the actions of another.
We have full control of the transporter. We should be beaming them all into space. Intra-ship beaming to space.
Your automatic setting is laid in, Captain.
I hope your computations are correct, Mr. Spock.
You will know in 7.9 seconds.
You're very specific again, Spock. You couldn't have said that a bit quicker. Said 8.
You bring a surprise.
Kang, wait. He must talk.
He just wants to talk.
Listen to him. We are all in danger.
Before you start killing, give me 1 minute.
Nope.
You out of your mind? What have they done to you?
Guess we had to have a fight.
It's your death, we win.
Have any more of your men died? We can't be killed. There's an alien aboard.
It keeps bringing us back. It brought Galloway back. Nah, it doesn't matter.
Look. Gang, for the rest of our lives. Senseless violence. While an alien has total control over us.
What? Strike me down.
In the heart, in the head. I won't stay dead. Next time I'll do the same to you. I'll kill you. While somewhere, some thing sits back and laughs.
He's coming around.
Listen to Kirk. He is telling the truth.
What do you think, Kang?
Klingons kill for their own purposes. All fighting must end, Captain.
How do we stop the rest of them?
A truce is ordered. The fighting is over. Lay down your weapons.
Your turn, Kang.
This is Kang. Cease hostilities.
Okay, that was easy. What about the ones that wouldn't obey orders? You know, like Johnson and Chekhov.
Appears to have weakened it, Captain. I suggest that good spirits might make an effective weapon.
Let's have a good old laugh. No any jokes, Kirk?
Get off my ship. We'll be on guard now. We'll be ready for you, so ship out!
Yeah, ship out.
Out already!
Oh, we're laughing. Yeah. Right, it's gone. Let's get back to the fighting. 40 versus 40. Winner gets the ship. It's over. We never got to know anything about the alien or its intentions. We just speculated. Based on its color. Ooh. Are we back with Apollo? So, anyone who thought that Galloway was dead, well, guess again. His twin brother, or him himself, he came back, he changed his name. From now on, he'll be Johnson. And they try to kill him again in this episode, but that's the cool orb of fire alien healed him up real good. You know? He appeared straight away. The episode starts with the planet. Then they're beaming down 5 seconds later and he's just there. He pulled the Leslie trick. Just turn up for work. Nobody will remember. Nobody will remember that you died. You know? Plus, technically we never saw a dead body. Right? Because he was vaporized in Omega Glory. And, you know, that means that anything could have happened to him. He could have teleported to another time and space. Anyway, he's back. Don't be surprised if you see him again. Maybe he's been in previous episodes in the background and I just haven't noticed him. But I definitely noticed him here. And I'll be looking out for more dead but not forgotten members of the crew next time. I really thought this was going to be, based on the title, it felt like it was going to be an episode all about peace. And I guess in the end it was. It was about how you can make peace with your deadly enemy. In the end, laughter is the best medicine for that. I like Kang a lot in this episode. He had a presence. His voice carries a presence. And the way he was acting also carried that same presence. Similar to Korb, but not quite the same. But far different to whichever Klingon Trelane was playing in the Tribbles episode, which seemed a bit more mischievous. This guy was not mischievous. He was all about the battle, you know? Strategy, defeating the enemy, taking his chances. He was ruthless. He was willing to let his wife die. She knew the risks. She was refusing to buy into any propaganda whatsoever for the whole episode, even up to and including Kirk rescuing her from Chekhov's advances. That was weird, by the way. We'll talk about that now. And also, the whole thing with the energy orb that she could see. Like, she could clearly see it. They're talking about it in front of her. Johnson comes in, crazed. We have to do something about him. She's visually seeing all of this. She's taking it all in. And she still thinks it's a trick. Because when Kirk goes to try and talk to Kang, she's like, "It's a trick!" You know? And it's not until Kirk pretends to, even though they said this openly in front of her, that they were going to pretend to threaten her life, even though he pretends to threaten her life, it's only when he doesn't follow through with that she's like, "You're not going to kill me?" So she's the least believable part of the episode. I say that tongue in cheek. We also had various crew members going slightly crazy, being slightly changed, altered. Like, let's just say every single member of the crew except for Sulu was affected. Uhura was affected because at one point she was so frustrated that she couldn't get through to Starfleet. It was very out of character for her. She was like, you know, she was real angry about it. And I was like, "Oh, this is a bit, you know, just keep trying. There's plenty of times you can't get through. You do your job. You're professional. That's what you normally do. You just keep trying. If it takes hours or days." But she was really frustrated. McCoy was really angry in sick bay. Wasn't he? I thought he was going to try and develop a biological weapon. The alien wouldn't have allowed it, but it might have allowed it to use it, but then it would have brought all the Klingons back. Scotty? Oh, he really let Spock have it, didn't he? He called him everything. Half-breed, freak, told him to quit Starfleet and go back to his people, or words to that effect. He was really, really He really took it out in Spock. Spock lashed out a little too. Didn't he? Talking about how serving with humans is difficult. Wow, Spock. How could you? Kirk lost it a little. When he was slapping Chekov around. And Chekov had implanted memories of a brother he never had. There's some interesting Sulu, as far as I can tell, was not affected and at any point by the alien. And he's the best at the swords. You know, maybe he didn't need any convincing. Maybe he's just, now's my time to shine. Finally, it's Sulu time. And the alien's like, well, okay, he's pre-made. He's ready. Don't need to expend any energy on that. Here are some things that aren't very clearly explained. The nature of the alien, where we're going, if we're going anywhere, in fact. We made a big deal about going towards the edge of the galaxy. We kept talking about the edge of the galaxy and maybe past the in-between galaxies, maybe into the... But we never... That is never an important point. You know, we could have been dead in space and the episode would still have worked the same. It was a distraction for me because I was like, is it from Andromeda? Is it an alien trying to get back to its home planet? Maybe it's feeding off the crew until it can get there, you know, because otherwise it'll die of starvation in deep space. But none of that is addressed or dealt with. It's thrown at us, but it's not something that is explained. The alien doesn't speak. It doesn't do anything except float there and change colors. That is it. That's all we visibly see it do. And we invent this story that happens to be correct, apparently correct, about what its purpose is, what its goals are, and how to get rid of it. So we do a great detective job in this episode. Now we can infer a lot of that based on what it's making us do and how people are coming back to, are being healed super quickly, and how everything is so balanced, and you know, the weapons are very equal. You know, we can infer a lot of that. But the alien itself doesn't tell us anything, and its true nature is still unclear to us. What did it actually want? We feel like it's getting energy from the anger and hatred we have, but you know, what if it doesn't get that? Is it really hungry? Does it need that? For how long does it need that? War, and it doesn't need to go anywhere. Are there more of them? These are all just left to the imagination. Also, it seems like Chekov was the only person given false memories of a brother that he never had. We never follow up on Chekov later. We slap him about, he goes unconscious, we carry him to sickbay. Wow, Kirk, you really did a number on him. But we never see a scene where he's like, oh wait, I don't have a brother, or what about my brother? Now, if in the next episode he talks about his brother, we're going to need to do something. And his hatred of Klingons, we're going to have to do something. But yeah, how the alien was affecting everybody. How it was affecting the Klingons, it didn't seem to be affecting the Klingons, or at least we didn't visibly see it affect the Klingons too much. They didn't need to be, a bit like Sulu, they were ready to go. They're on an alien ship, they're being held, they're given an opportunity to escape, and they just want to take control of the ship. Everything the Klingons do needs no explanation. They're not super amped up. They're not super angry. They're doing exactly what you would expect them to do. You know? Hey, better. That's good news for the alien. It doesn't need to expend half the energy. Plus, it locked. I'm not entirely sure where the extra 360 people are on the ship right now. On the lower decks, on somewhere that I can't quite visualize in my brain, Are they trying to get out? Are they trying to get to the shuttle bay? Are they trying to dig their way up? Are they knocking Morse code on the deck above? Do they know what's happening to the ship? Are they going to die of starvation and all of that stuff? When Kang cut off the oxygen, did he cut it off to those people too? I don't know. But that was just to, we just needed to get rid of them so that we could have the episode we had. That's the only purpose for that. So it doesn't need to be explained. And it's necessary for the plot to happen. Unlike in the episode with the M5. We didn't need to get rid of the rest of the crew in the M5 episode. Let's face it. The 400 people that are on the ship are very rarely felt in an episode. You could convince me there are 50 people on the Enterprise. You could convince me there are 400, but we don't get a sense for the vastness of the ship from in a production way. You know, the most people we ever see, maybe when they're eating somewhere, you know? Maybe when they're all walking through the corridor. But you don't really get a sense for the vastness of the ship. Because we're confined to maybe 6 or 7 particular rooms. So, yeah, we didn't miss those 360. First time we've teleported from the ship to the ship. I'm going to say that it's only possible to do it from the transporter room to the ship, and not from somewhere in the ship to the transporter room or elsewhere. Also, we were holding the Klingons in the beam at the start of the episode. We could have put them anywhere. And it seems to me that if it was a fair fight, the Klingons probably would have won the day. They seized control of engineering. If it was 40 versus 40, they seized control of engineering pretty quickly. And I'm not sure we would have been able to get it back. Then again, we have Spock, who can just... You know? So maybe... Now I feel like the alien. I kind of want to see how it plays out. No interfering. No bringing people back. Just, we know the ship inside out. We know exactly what to do. We can release the gas at any point. But no, because they cut off the power. The Klingons cut off our power and our air supply. And that's pretty much it, right? But then again, Sulu was going to repair that, and maybe the alien was stopping Sulu from... No, because the alien brought it back. Sulu wasn't going to be able to do it. See, I give this victory to the Klingons. This specific scenario, when there's 40 versus 40, once the rest of the crew are locked away, the Klingons would have won the day and killed everybody on the ship and taken their prize back to the Klingon homeworld. First time we've seen a Klingon woman, I think. I'm not entirely sure of that, but when I saw her, there were two of them, and when I saw her, I was like, I don't know if we've seen a Klingon woman before. They all had goatees. They were all very heavily made up. Very dark makeup in this episode. So they're settling on an aesthetic. And yeah, the lead Klingon was great. He had a great presence. And I thought Kirk might take him one-on-one, hand-to-hand. He sort of did. He had the sword to his neck. But I think it might have been a 50-50 situation. Not a dove to be seen in this episode. No doves were seen or hurt in the creation of this episode. And the alien planet was barely seen at all. That's where the entity was, calling both ships. Come to me, I wish to feed on your anger and hate. Chekhov's not feeling enough anger. I'm going to give him a backstory. I'm not going to give anybody else one, but... Here, dude, your brother. You got a brother now. Scotty, you're just super racist now. Doc, more crotchety than normal. Sulu, you're good to go. Uhura, freak out. Kirk. And the Klingons are just fine. So, did I enjoy that episode? Yeah, I enjoyed it. I think... Could they have done a bit more with it, maybe? Maybe. But I'm not quite sure what I would have done with it. You know, I could say make the alien more... Like, flesh it out a bit more. Give it a bit of character. But... To what end, I don't know. Maybe give it more of an interesting motivation than just keeping them feeding off their hate. Maybe it's doing it reluctantly. Maybe it does feed off their hate, but it only needs them for a few days to get to it, where it's going, and it doesn't intend to hurt them at all. It's just like, look, I need a ride. I'm sorry I'm putting you through this for 3 days. I'll let you go at the end. Have fun, you know. Think of it as training. Think of it as advanced training. Here, I brought back a dead crewman for you as well, as a gift. Here's Galloway. And the Klingons get a dead crewman as well. Here's a guy you lost. You know? In exchange. I know that sounds weird, but maybe the episode is just fine the way it is. They laughed at the end. Yep. Sent it packing. I'm surprised, actually, because everything we'd seen up until that point was that we couldn't quickly snap people out of it. We couldn't just give an order over an intercom and get them all to go, oh, well... Hey, look, we got orders. We gotta drop our weapons. But my brother. You heard the captains. We're not fighting anymore. Maybe the alien was just losing its grip. Bit by bit. Maybe it just got sick of us. Maybe it didn't want to hear one of Kirk's boring speeches again. It was like, ah, not this nonsense. I'm out of here. Right. Let's check the title of the next one. It's a long one. It's very long. It's "For the World is Hollow and I've Touched the Sky." Okay. We'll see what all that's about next time. Thank you for joining me for episode 7, Dave the Dove. And, yeah, until next time, just think, do I have a brother? Do I have a brother? Just think that to yourself. Try and get confirmation from people you know. See if you've ever mentioned your brother to them. And if they're like, what? Then you know something's up. Also, be more aware of your surroundings. That orb was following them. It was going down corridors with them. It was on the bridge. Nobody saw it. Nobody saw it until it was convenient to see it, and then it just sat there looking at them. It was like, oh, I've been spotted. I must stay here. And only for the Klingon, only for Kang saw it. Kang wouldn't have believed him, I don't think, if Kirk hadn't pointed at it. Look, look. And then Kang's like, oh, Klingons fight for themselves. They don't fight for nobody else. Anyway. Think about it all. Think about it. I'll see you.